housekeeping to take care of. We have our mayor with us here today, Ted Denton. And if I can ask him to come up. He's going to take care of some things for us.
Thanks, Joe.
I think that means I'm supposed to sweep the room. I'm not sure.
Thank you. It's a pleasure being here today. And we had the State of the City address a few days ago at the Kiwanis Club meeting and implemented a new award in the city of Rochester. And Joe and Amy asked me to acknowledge that recipient. He's here today, and what the award's all about. It's called the Mayor's Citizenship Award. It's going to be an annual award. It's going to be for a citizen of Rochester that has done something unique to advance our community, improve the efforts of our community, make Rochester, make the area a better place to live. And the very first recipient, someone who just knocked it out of the park last year, he was the founder of the Citizens Action Committee 3 years ago, started a campaign implementing some legislature that would limit the sale of pseudoephedrine out of our local drug stores, give our druggists some tools to work with when selling pseudoephedrine to the public. Before that, it was pretty much an open door. And pseudoephedrine, for those of you who don't know, is one of the major components in the manufacturing of meth. And at the time this individual stood up, and this is what I love, every one of these committee members were just citizens of Rochester. And at the time this committee was formed and started forward, they said, stop, no more in our community. We were number three in meth lab production in the state of Indiana when they started out. And as of the figures last week, from a year ago now, we're way down. Meth lab production in Fulton County this last year dropped off by 50% as a result of the legislation. The committee was instrumental in getting our city council and our county commissioners to make history by uniting for the first time in the chamber meeting together and doing a common piece of legislation for the first time ever in the history of the community. And it was an ordinance restricting the sale of pseudoephedrine. It then was spearheaded and taken under arm by Senator Randy Head. And the culmination of his efforts was Senate Bill 80, which was a mirror image of the local legislation. But we were operating for some time here in the community under our local legislation. So we were really, really stepping out and ahead of the curve in the state of Indiana in doing this. And now everybody, of course, is under the state law, and things are just happening all over the place. That individual is here today, and I'm very, very pleased to recognize the first recipient of the Mayor's Citizenship Award, Mr. Val Pimperton. Would you stand, please, Val?
Thank you, Mayor Denton. I accept that award on behalf of our committee. Without the passionate effort of Senator Head, there would be no meth lab elimination law. I ask you to stand and give Senator Head a standing ovation.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. That is, without a doubt, the very best introduction I think I've ever had. My hats are off to the committee, and it sounds like we're in a mutual admiration society. But we get, as legislators, a lot of people who call us or write us or Facebook us or email us, saying, here's a problem, you just go solve it. and get back to me when you figured out how to solve it and why it's been done yet. This committee stands out to me because they came up with a solution for the problem before they ever brought it to the legislature. And said, we've got a mechanism that we think will work. This will stop meth lab production to a very significant degree. And in fact, it already is. And we'd like your help. And I was knocked off my feet when they came and had the meeting because I assumed, like most meetings, it was going to be a meeting about a problem. Here's the extent of the problem in our community. Here's how many meth labs we have a year. Please help us. And they were already 25 to 30 steps beyond that. So it was very easy to say, yes, I'll take what you've done and try to make it a state law. And it was a cooperative effort among a lot of people. And I'm glad that it's working here and it's working all over the state of Indiana. That's fantastic. I told Jack, you know, after that introduction, maybe I should just leave. This is as good as it's ever going to get. When I was driving up, I noticed that this room was going to be full because the parking lot across the street was full before I could get here and try to park in the Banquet Center parking lot. And for that, I think, number one, we've got to thank the Chamber and Farm Bureau. You guys have done a fantastic job. Rochester usually had the most people at town hall meetings of anywhere in my district, but now you've topped yourselves. And so maybe it's just because Jack Jordan's here, because there's never this many people before Jack got elected. So we thank you for that. The way that we're scheduled today is that we've each got about 15 minutes, and I've got about five topics I want to talk about. So buckle in, here we go. I'm very fortunate to be chairman of the Task Force on Substance Abuse and Child Safety. We meet year-round. We've got a lot of experts on the committee, and they're all volunteers. There's no money in the budget for this. But we meet and talk about things that we can do in our society to try to help keep children safer and stop the scourge of substance abuse. And as you can imagine, those problems are deep and they are wide and there's absolutely no easy solutions for anything. But the task force voted out three bills that I'm trying to bring to the state senate, and a couple of these are moving. I hope all three. One that presents us a lot of potential is telehealth, meaning someone seeing a doctor or a mental health professional, a medical provider, over some type of technology like Skype. Or something on your tablet, so that you don't have to actually physically travel to a doctor's office. The problem with this, and that people are really worried about, is you know, we just had a doctor in Miami County got arrested for 55 counts of felony, script drug with writing too many prescriptions for pills for people who didn't need them. And if we open this up to with the use of the digital technology that we have, you can have a doctor halfway around the world just creating a virtual pill mill here in Indiana, and we don't want to do that. So the controls on telehealth are very tight. And I understand that. But for instance, Ford County in Logansport uses a child psychologist or psychiatrist from Pittsburgh because we don't have enough of those people in the state of Indiana, especially in rural areas. It's hard to get services. And so they try to use this. But the rule is that a doctor has to meet face-to-face with a patient before using telehealth. And that guy from Pittsburgh is not coming here. He doesn't have to come here. He's in high demand where he is and lots of other places. So we're trying to start a pilot program that would allow a doctor to meet with an adolescent or a child and prescribe things that are normally used for mental health conditions. And these would be strictly controlled, strictly watched to make sure he's not prescribing opioids, pain meds, that kind of thing, to make sure that doesn't get out of control. Telehealth represents enormous potential that we're not using. And again, especially for rural Indiana, this is a way to get doctors places that they aren't or other mental health professionals. One that I think is going to move really well that just passed committee unanimously also deals with a similar topic. We need to get more addiction services people, more counselors here into the state of Indiana. We've got a lot of people looking for help who just can't get it. And again, this is specifically to rural Indiana, although the problem is urban as well. One thing the task force found is that if you are, say, a licensed clinical social worker in the state of Kentucky and you practice for 30 years and then your spouse gets a transfer and moves to Indiana and you come and you want to set up shop, you can't do it. Because Indiana says to get a license here, you have to have 200 hours of supervised practice. So if someone's done that job for 30 years and done well, had no disciplinary complaints and no problems whatsoever, they move to Indiana, we demand that they go back to college and pay however many thousands of dollars it takes to take this course and be supervised for 200 hours. And what they do is they just say, it's not worth it, I'm just done. And we lose good people. And if we were full of people, and that profession was so crowded we couldn't hold anymore, I can understand. But it's not very crowded. We're in a critical situation. We need to get these people here. So Senate Bill 59 will simply say that if you've practiced for 5 years, you've got no disciplinary complaints, you can come to Indiana and apply for a license, and it doesn't matter that you haven't had the 200 hours supervised. You've worked over 5 years. You've worked over 200 hours in the profession. You can just do it. The third one is trying to get more money allocated for to provide substance abuse services in schools. And it wouldn't be hiring someone in the school. It would be taking a vendor or a provider who's already in the community and providing the school with money to hire these people. And that would be so that if a student has a problem, you get to the problem while it's in its infancy instead of waiting until they're an addict and trying to solve it at that time. It's much more futile. It's much more expensive to wait until the problem gets worse. And so we're trying to strike at it earlier. I think all of you would be happy to know that Amy from the Chamber of Commerce got the local superintendents together to talk to us about some things we can do for rural and small schools. And Bill has some important bills on that I'm going to let him talk about. Just a couple of things that came out of those meetings for me was that I went to the Rural and Small Schools Association and again said, give us some specifics on some things that will help. And we talked to your local superintendents about that as well. One thing that was a quirk in school evaluation is that if you have a child with an intellectual disability, not the school's fault, not the parents' fault. This child was born this way, and they're not capable of graduating. We had an animal where you take them off the diploma track and put them on a certificate track, but that would count against the school's graduation rate. So when you look at the evaluations for schools, you say, oh, they're not graduating enough students. Well, it's not the school's fault. This is, I'm tempted to say this, just stupid. It's silly, probably, is a more tactful term to use, that aspect of the law even exists. So I wrote a bill to say that if a child is taken off the diploma track, because they're not capable, no matter how hard they try and no matter how much the school does for them, that shouldn't count against the school. I was in the Education Committee the first time it met, and I was glad to see Senator Rotz had written the exact same bill, and his bill was moving, so he's had me as a co-author there. And that's something that's come out of our meetings. There are also a couple of bills pending in the Senate that are going to try to move away, at least to begin to move away, placing so much emphasis on the ISAT test or whatever other test that we use in evaluating teachers and looking at student growth at least as a factor and hopefully later on as more of a factor than the high stakes test. Bill and I met with the governor on Thursday. One of the things I brought up is the problem with teacher bonuses. We've got a system in place where it seems that highly effective teachers in affluent school districts got much bigger bonuses than highly effective teachers elsewhere. And again, that is silly. It makes absolutely no sense. I know in Wayne Township on the west side of Indy, highly effective teachers got a bonus of $42. We're a few miles away in Carmel. It was more than several hundred. I think it might have been over 1,000. Highly effective teacher somewhere is as good as a highly effective teacher somewhere else. They're both highly effective. And stratifying the bonus structure makes absolutely no sense. And so an idea I heard in the Senate and pitched to the governor was saying all highly effective teachers should get the exact same bonus. It shouldn't matter where they teach. They're highly effective. They've done exactly what we want them to do. And I'm hopeful for that as well. This year, I happened to be carrying Senate Bill 1. I didn't file it first, but Senator Long reserved it and called and said it was going to be Senate Bill 1, and it deals with regulations involving vaping. Probably no one in here vapes. I don't. But what it is that manufacturers make something called e-liquid. You put the cartridge in an instrument that turns that into smoke, and you smoke it. And the reason, and it's not a big economic development tool or anything like that. The only reason I'm involved with it is we passed a bill a couple of years ago, and again last year, that so over-regulates this business. And I feel very strongly about government getting too involved in over-regulating. Some more silly things that existed was in that industry, we said if you didn't have a permit to manufacture by July 31st of 2016, you never could in the state of Indiana ever. And I don't know why we would do that to any industry. We said that manufacturers had to hire a security company to video them, watching them in their manufacturing process that had to take place in a clean room behind locked doors, and that the security company had to have someone on staff certified in dealing with roll-top steel doors or modified metal doors or something called borrowed lights and a locksmith. Yeah, you're laughing, and you should be. This makes no sense. Turns out only one security company in the state of Indiana met all those requirements. And what do you know? They got all those contracts. I don't know how that happened. We were told during the hearings there'd be more than one security company, but it's only one. And I say it's a monopoly. Other people say it's just a perceived monopoly. Either way, it's a problem. And so we're trying to loosen up those regulations and allow more business people to get into that business if that's the business they want to be in. Freezing them out simply doesn't make any sense. The bill I've had this year that's gotten more publicity, I think, than any bill I ever had that I never intended was a bill to raise the pay for elected officials in the executive branch of state government. It'd be your state auditor, your state treasurer, your state attorney general, and so on and so forth. And I did this because I was talking to Curtis Hill after the election. He's our new attorney general, and he pointed out how much of a pay cut prosecuting attorneys have to take to become attorney general. And thought about it. Jennifer McCormick was a school superintendent in Yorktown. She took a huge pay cut to become state superintendent. Our new state auditor was a county auditor and took a huge pay cut to go from the county to the state, and this didn't make much sense to me. Those salaries were last updated in 2008, and so the bills had said, as originally written, that they would get raises that would go into effect after the next election cycle, 2018. So after we chose Secretary of State and Auditor and Treasurer, that's who's up in 2018. And I've gotten several reactions. Some people have said, you know what, we need to attract good people. And I think that if salaries are low, good people don't run. We scare some of them away from both parties. Others have said public officials should never get raises. They know what the salary is when they run. They shouldn't be doing it for the money. They shouldn't be getting rewarded right now. Others have said that might be a good idea, but boy, Senator Head, this is horrible timing because you guys are talking about raising a gas tax. And why would you raise a gas tax and give people raises at the same time? And they call me all kinds of names I'm not going to repeat right here on a family show. And others have said, you know, I don't know enough about it. And so it's going to become a summer study committee. It's not going to pass and not going to go into law this year. And some of you probably have some questions for me about it, so I'll stay after and consider each and every one of them. Some of you have weighed in already, which I certainly appreciate. As far as the road funding goes, that's a House bill. It's cleared committee. It hasn't gotten to the Senate, so I'm going to let my House comrades talk about that more because they know more about it. I can tell you a couple of things. One is I haven't made up my mind what to do about it yet. And two, the price tag to me seems really high for how much money this would raise. It would raise $1 billion every year as written, which is just over 7% of the budget. Typically, I think with these things, when someone makes the ask, when they write the bill, they ask for the price tag to be high, and through the course of negotiation in both chambers, it goes lower. I think that we will see that happen. If this passes the House and the Senate, and there's an agreement, I think that it's going to be for lower than what was originally asked, and that's typical. But when I talk to you, and when you ask questions, or when you email me or Facebook me, I guess it'd be just a couple of observations. No matter what the final bill looks like, certainly, if we tax more and spend more money, we can have better roads. If we don't raise taxes, we can save you money and have roads that are not as nice. And I just want you to tell me which one you want. And knowing what the district wants will certainly help me going forward. I think I've used up my 15 minutes, maybe 20. Sorry about that. Thank you all for being here. It is impressive to see such a group come out so early, and I look forward to your questions and talking to you afterward. I appreciate it. Hi there, it's great to be here and great to see such a fine turnout this morning. I do need to thank Fulton County for something. Again, for those of you that don't know, my name is Jack Jordan. I'm a freshman representative. I represent all of Marshall County and a large portion of Fulton County. But I want to thank you for training me. During the campaign, when I went places, inevitably my wife would be there, but when she wasn't there, I would immediately be asked down here, where's your wife? And I'd say, well, I'm here. And it was like, yeah, whatever. Well, I went down to the State House. And the first week was training, and then we kind of got into a little bit of business. And I actually had my own identity. They actually called me Jack Jordan, which was really nice. Well, my wife went down there for a week because Representative Gutwein's wife heads up a spouses group, and she went down there and went through orientation on what it's like to be a spouse. Well, my wife doesn't quite take it that way. She meets every security guard, every custodian, everybody. So for 2 weeks, I was Jack Jordan down there. And guess what my name is now? I'm Hope's husband. I'll go into a door, and the state police trooper, the guards will say, oh, hi, Hope's husband. So I wish I was exaggerating. I'm not. So when they're always asking where you are, I go, she has a job and has to go to it. So anyway, thank you for training me along that lines. Just general impressions on my freshman time down there as a new representative. First of all, it's humbling. So it's humbling to represent you every day because our decisions that are made that will affect your finances, will affect your life, will affect the safety of our children and grandchildren. Don't have them yet, but hopefully soon. And so it's just humbling, both to stand here to represent you. Walking into the State House is humbling every day, to walk through the corridors, to think that I've got that privilege. And then
The best coffee in the State House is in the governor's office. So to go get my cup of coffee, Governor Bowen's picture is the picture right above the coffee there. And for those of you who don't know, he was born and raised in Fulton County. And the district that he had was actually the district I have now after they redistrict. It's Marshall County and Fulton County. It's almost exactly his district. So it's humbling every day to get my nice coffee out of the governor's office and look up and realize I have a solemn duty in representing you. The other thing is just the quality of people in Indianapolis is amazing. The quality of representation here, I know they're high quality, but the representative, friend, Gutwein, Senator Head, they're A-team down in Indianapolis. And it's probably hard for you to know that. I mean, you kind of know it, but when you go down there and see their leadership, it's humbling to be associated with the three of them in representing you. I mean, seriously, they're A-team. I do want to say one negative thing about Indianapolis or the legislature is there's just way too many laws. My initial impression is that we just have way too many laws. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of pounds of laws, and every law that comes through, there are good laws, don't get me wrong, but many laws that come through take away just a little bit of our personal freedom. And then there's another law that takes away a little bit of our personal freedom. So I as a freshman representative, I'm stunned by the number of laws. We started out with 1,641. It went up to 1,680. I think we're down to 600 roughly in the Rep and Senate. And so I'm just hoping that as a culture that we can, I would like to move it in a direction where there's less laws so there's more freedom. The thing I am encouraged about is Representative Gutwein is in a leadership position to really take a role on reducing regulation, reducing the burden of government, and there's a high degree of confidence he's going to have a significant impact, and he'll talk about that in a minute because he's in just an amazing situation and is already starting to voice concerns around that. As far as priorities in the session, there are five. The first one is obvious. We want to be on solid ground financially and maintain our AAA bond rating. Now, that's financial gobbledygook to most of us. But it's important, not just for state government, but it impacts everybody in this room. Many of you are on city councils, county councils. That impacts what you're going to pay if you try to bond anything. So it's not just about state finances. It's about local and county finances to help you out. So we're not going to do anything that would jeopardize our financial status. The second thing is, and we'll talk about this, I'm sure, during Q&A quite a bit, is the infrastructure issue. I think most people agree we need to invest in infrastructure. It's not just quality of life. I mean, all of us don't like my wife. We've got two bent rims and two tires blown in the last year. My son, same thing. You know, there is a quality of life issue. We're spending a lot of money as a family on bad roads. But it's more about economic development. Indiana is dependent on manufacturing, probably more so than any other state. And if you're a manufacturing state, you have got to have a way of getting your goods and services from Indiana across the country. And so it is imperative that we have infrastructure at the state level, at the county level, at the city level, so we can truly develop our economy like we need to. Infrastructure is key to that, and I can't emphasize that enough. So it's at this point, it's not the what for most people, it's the how we do it. There's a proposal, House Bill 1002, has some good ideas in it. Other people have good ideas. I think we're at the point right now on trying to figure out what the best idea and a sustainable plan is for the next 10 to 20 years. The third area is education, and I'm blessed to be on the education committee. The issue of flexibility at the local level is important to me, having been a school board president for 7 years. The idea of teaching, becoming a profession that is compensated is important to me. This ISTEP fiasco that all of us whether we're parents, grandparents, we have nieces and nephews, is going to be fixed. I guarantee that. So it's education, but it's not just education so we can do better on tests. It's how does Indiana have an educational system that inspires every young person? If they're off to college, that we prepare them for college. If they're great welders, then great at going to be great farmers with where technology is going. We need to be great at preparing people for whatever endeavor they go into, whether it's a machinist or whether it's a physician, that we have an educational system that does that. Fourthly is, and it kind of is on the last note, is workforce development. Indiana is number one in the Midwest as far as the environment to do business. We're in the top five in most surveys on the state to do business in this country. The one area that we fall short is workforce readiness, to have people that are prepared to do the jobs that we're going to have now and in the future. And I don't have all the answers on this one, but it's a priority, and I look forward to seeing what we do in this session and sessions to come to develop that. And last is support public safety. Government is one of its primary roles is to keep its citizens safe. And I'm blessed to serve on the Veterans Affairs and Public Safety Committee. And there's some things coming through for state police that I think will be helpful. Some other things to keep us safe as citizens in an area that is extremely important, as you might imagine. And part of that is this whole drug crisis. It just breaks all of our hearts, because I bet there's not a person in this room who isn't affected, either through a family member, a friend, a neighbor, somebody down the road. And the kids, we've got a family that lives within 100 yards of us. Doggone it. The parents are just making incredibly horrible life choices, and their three young kids, they're in a meth house. And they're in and out. The kids are back and forth from Child Protective Services. And it just breaks your heart. And so we've got to make progress in this. And government can help. It's not the ultimate solution. I'm hoping we all band together, churches and nonprofits, et cetera, to help most of these kids that are in horrible, horrible situations. So anyway, those are the five priorities that we're focusing on. I'm confident we'll make progress in those. But again, I'll be redundant. I can't say enough good things about the leadership that we have currently representing this county at the state level, as well as county commissioners and local folks that serve. Just class people, and I thank you for all you do. And now you're going to see the A-team as they step up and just really impress you with their leadership and things that are going to help all of us get done. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack, and thank you for those kind comments. We'll see if they're still reflected at the end of the session. Things happen along the way, you know. So, but thank you. And Fulton County is very fortunate to have a new representative, Jack Jordan, because he is, as you could tell, very poised and excellent speaker. And he's going to represent Rochester and northern Fulton County extremely well. I'm Bill Friend. I represent District 23. I have one township in Fulton County, Liberty Township, or the Nyona Lake and town of Fulton is located. The rest of the district is most of Miami County and about seven townships in Cass County, including the city of Logansport. So Peru and Logan are the biggest population centers. Most of what I have, though, is small towns, farms, some factories, some elevators, things of that nature. We are a very rural and agricultural district, and I'll talk a little bit about that when we get to the education portion. In the legislature, I serve on three committees, agriculture, environmental, and natural resources. And I tell people that the speaker obviously wants to keep me outdoors. So, then along the way, I serve as speaker pro tem. So just like last Thursday, we were going into session at 10 o'clock, and at 2 minutes till 10, I got a text message on my phone that said, just heads up, speaker's in a meeting, you have to be up there and preside. So it's nice to have a little prep time, but you don't always get it. This session, of course, the only thing we actually have to do is make a budget for the next 2 years. And the budget for the next 2 years is going to be approximately $32 billion. $32 billion. And we in Indiana are very fortunate because of some sound financial management, and we have a surplus, I prefer to call it a balance of all funds, approaching $2 billion. And during the campaign and all of last fall, you heard people saying, well, why don't you spend that surplus down? Why don't you spend that surplus down and you can increase payments to schools and local governments and to universities, etc. Well, let's do a little math problem. $32 billion, a two-year budget, so that's 24 months. So if you divide 32 by 24, you get something like $1.33 billion every month. And I think you can understand that it doesn't take much of a downturn in the national economy and the state economy. And if we're spending $1.33 billion per month for pretty much static expenses, that almost $2 billion surplus or balance doesn't last very long. So we need to maintain that balance as we go through this budgeting process, and hopefully with an unemployment rate down to 4%, then with people working and paying taxes through payroll deductions, etc., hopefully we will be able to maintain the surplus and create a budget that takes care of schools and other opportunities as well. I want to call your attention to this handout that's on your tables, because it does a really good pie chart of the budget breakdown. And you'll see on there that we spend 52% of that $32 billion. 52% goes to K-12 education. Another 12% goes to higher education. That's your IU, Purdue, Ball State, Indiana State. And so those things I think show or demonstrate the dedication that Indiana has to education here, and the fact that we appropriate that money, and we appropriate that money because we believe in education and we want to do as much as we possibly can with the reality that every budget is a spending priority list, and we just have to be as generous as possible and try to meet all the needs as best we can. Big deal this year that people are talking about is House Bill 1002, which is the infrastructure bill to improve or maintain the infrastructure here in the state of Indiana. The proposal that's on the table went through a joint committee meeting of Ways and Means and Roads and Transportation. 7.5 hours of testimony from any number of people in the House chamber, and the meeting seemed to just go on and on and on. But it includes a 10-cent gas tax increase. It includes a $15 registration fee that would be paid when you buy your plates, $15 on every vehicle when you buy your license plates. It increases the diesel tax. There's an index so that the gas tax is going to fluctuate with the price of the fuel as well. That's hooked in there as well. The committees didn't just pop this out of the air, out of the sky. There's been a study, a committee that's been meeting and looking at numbers and looking at miles traveled and costs of construction, all of those things. They've been doing this for about 3 years now. And last year we had a bill that was introduced in the House and did not proceed. This year the bill is introduced again. The committee's determined that we needed about $1 billion per year for infrastructure needs, maintenance, construction, bridges, etc. Much of that at the local level, that would be for county roads, bridges, city streets, town streets. The average cost, if this bill is to proceed, the estimate is that it's about $5 a month for the Hoosier who drives 12,000 miles a year. Probably up here where we live, it's going to be more than that because we live in a rural area and we have to drive more. But we also would like to have highways and county roads and streets that are safe. And so, difficult as this bill is, I don't want to raise taxes for anybody, but we have to take a look at how we fund things. You know, we leased a toll road years ago, and we don't have another toll road. We don't have any more rabbits we can pull out of the hat. For many years, we funded the state police out of the Motor Vehicle Highway Fund. For many years, we took money out of the Motor Vehicle Highway Fund for the Bureau of Motor Vehicles. That's all done. We don't do that anymore. All of that money stays for road construction and maintenance. The sales tax on gasoline. Indiana is one of seven states that charges sales tax on gasoline. Heretofore, all of that money has gone to the state general fund. 3 years ago, we started moving that money from the general fund to the motor vehicle highway fund. So of that 7 cents tax on gasoline, right now, 2.5 cents is going to motor vehicle highway, and over the next 3 to 4 years, if this bill is to proceed, the rest of that money will be recaptured and go to motor vehicle highway fund in order to get to that $1 billion per year that we're looking at. There's also included a $150 per year registration fee for electric vehicles. Well, why do we do that? Well, think about it. The electric car, even though it's usually a small vehicle, but it doesn't use any gasoline or pay any taxes for the maintenance of the roads or streets that it uses. We'll entertain questions on that, I'm sure, in the future. On the education question, Randy mentioned, and Doug as well, that we met with Amy and Fulton County superintendents, and we talked this summer and fall about education, specifically the small schools, and the fact that most small rural schools, the consolidations that took place back in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, most of them are experiencing a decline in population, student population. So, and I can give you the number that I use all the time. North Miami, not so many years ago, had about 1,250 students. They're now down to, their ADM was 920. They've lost 300 or more students in just a few years. The school funding formula now, the money follows the student. Money follows the child. So, and in the school funding formula, North Miami per student receives about $6,500. So we can do the math, 300 times 6,500, that's money that the superintendent and the administration, the school board, they don't have it. It's gone. And they have to manage. So that means they have to cut positions, they have to freeze salaries, they have to concentrate and maybe do without some programs. Now, last summer I had lunch with the superintendent at Hamilton Southeastern, Hamilton County. 22,500 students in one school district. 22,500 students. Now, by comparison, Logansport is about 18,000 people. So the total number of residents in that city is less than the number of students in Hamilton Southeastern. And yet, when we make policy for education, we try to do it one size fits all, and it gets to be extremely difficult. Now, many of my colleagues, especially the ones from the donut counties, Hamilton, Hendricks, Hancock, Johnson, they say, well, why don't you guys just consolidate? Consolidate. Combine. And I just explained to them that there are two things they don't understand. Time and distance. You don't want a six-year-old on a school bus for 2 to 3 hours. That's not good. That's not good policy. And that's not a good solution. And one of the things I've asked the Teachers Association, the ISTA, they said, why don't you and the Farm Bureau form an alliance? I believe I called it maybe even an unholy alliance, because oftentimes they don't agree. But I said, why don't you guys form an alliance? Because the farmers who pay the property taxes to pay for the debt relief, transportation, and the capital projects on those schools want them open. They don't want bad things to happen. So maybe that's going to occur. I'm asking for the small schools grant to move through Ways and Means. Here's how it would work. A school with 2,400 students or less could receive an extra $100 on their appropriation. A school with 1,000 students or less could receive $200 on their per student appropriation. We got to start the conversation some way, just or someplace. Just as with the transportation bill, we have to have a starting point. As we're doing the school funding, we have to have a starting point. So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm going to try to work it through Ways and Means. I have some other things that we can discuss, but we have to get Doug Gutwein up here to wrap this up. And I thank you again. Fulton County is always great. You turn out such a great crowd every Saturday morning, and I thank you for your attention, because I know there's other things that you could be doing. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Excuse me, I'd like to say a few things about my colleagues first. I had the opportunity to serve as state delegate this past election when Senator Head was running for Attorney General. And you all know I don't like to pass compliments out to Senator Head, but I have to in this situation. I was extremely proud of the way he ran his campaign for that position. He and his wife were great ambassadors for our district, and he didn't win, but I was extremely proud to call him my friend. So let's give him a hand. But don't get used to that, Head. Representative...
Just the way I wrote it.
Yeah. Representative Jack Jordan is our new representative for part of this part of the county. He's slipping into that position very nicely. And Frank and I agree with him. I've said this for going on 9 years now. Why do we have so many bills? It's like maybe for every bill we pass, we should repeal about five. I mean, it's just so we won't go any further with that. And my friend, Bill Fred, my mentor, the only thing I have to say about him is he told me, he says, don't talk about Planned Parenthood today. So, just a couple of things that we're working on. The retired folks, the retired teachers, retired state employees. Tuesday we'll be running the 13th check again through employment, labor, and pensions. I don't see any problem with that. The other bill we're running again is my sales tax exempt bill for drainage tile. Last year I had a $2 million tax credit, and I'm asking for the same thing this year because they won't flat out repeal or just give me this tax relief. But a tax credit for the ag industry, I think we might get that this year, which will, I keep telling them this is the only bill in the state house will actually make the state money. And no one can believe that, but it's a fact. The other bill I'm working on in our rural areas, the theft of scrap metal and so forth. A couple of years ago, it was running rampant. Scrap was $250 a ton, and it created a lot of jobs for thieves. There was no way for law enforcement to keep up with this. So for the last couple of years, we've been working on a bill to set up a database so the scrap dealers, and my intention here was not to make it cumbersome for the honest people, but to help catch the bad guys. So when we're trying to set up a database, actually there's Ohio has one, it's working well, where a scrap dealer, and I tried to print off some of the stuff this morning, my printer didn't work, so I'm going to wing it. Scrap dealer, when you come in to sell scrap, he will get a tremendous amount of information, along with pictures. He'll take a picture of what you're bringing in, he'll get your driver's license, a picture of you, a tremendous amount of information, and it will be sent to this database if we can get it passed this year. This database will be held for 2 years. So when someone comes in and says, hey, law enforcement, I had such and such stolen from my property, there's pictures, there's data, there's all kind of information, particularly on the people selling it. And the honest scrap dealers are very much on board with this. They think it's going to obviously help their industry. So we will have meetings tomorrow morning with folks about the database that Ohio has, and we're going to try to get a licensing to have that in Indiana. The other thing is, as Jack mentioned, I'm no longer the chairman of Employment, Labor, and Pensions. During organization day, the speaker called and asked if I would chair the select committee on government reduction. And that's precisely what it sounds like. We have laws, regulations, codes on the book that haven't been used for years. We need to get rid of them. So I have asked the governor's people, Indiana cities and towns, Association of Counties, Indiana Manufacturers Association, like the Chamber, anybody, any organization, to send out to their members, if there's something that you're doing that's redundant, we don't need to do it, reports in triple. Did anybody ever find out where the third copy went and who read it? I don't know. But this is an example. On Tuesday, a week from Tuesday, I'll be hearing a bill on the select committee. We got rid of the heritage tax, right? There's no more inheritance tax. But all the tax issues are still on the books about inheritance tax. So, and this stuff doesn't sound like it's that big a deal, but it is. For example, there's a bill about to repeal the oversight committee on the inspect committee that watches over the committees that watches over our drugs. Well, how many people we need watching people? And these people get paid when they come down to Indianapolis once a year. They get paid $508 plus mileage to come down for a couple hours and talk about what the inspect committee is doing. Well, I'm not sure that we need all of this type of stuff. Another example I gave was last week ago, Thursday, we were not in session due to the inauguration. So I drove around to some of my courthouses and town halls and so forth and told them what I was my new committee was about. So I go in the auditor's office and I'm telling them what I'm doing, and I said, what's that big book over there on the shelf? Well, that's the minutes from the commissioner's meeting. And I said, so I need to find something for 1976, April 3rd. Where do I find that? Well, it's in the basement of the jail. So how long will it take me to find what I'm looking for? She goes, I have no idea. This is the 21st century. Why do we have big books? Why don't we have a flash drive where they put these meetings on this thumb drive, flash drive, whatever you want to call it? I said, you can keep 50 years in a shoebox. So this is kind of what this committee is all about, just to get rid of stuff that we don't need, and you county people, you city people, this is what I'm looking for. So you should have gotten information from the organizations I mentioned. So I don't think it's going to be a big deal this year, but through the summer, I'd like to see a lot of stuff. Let's just get rid of it. We don't need it. So it doesn't sound all that exciting, but it's kind of a new charge for me. I'd had enough of the labor stuff after 8 years. It was kind of wearing me out. So and businesses. If you've got something that the government's in your way you don't need, I want to hear from you. We can make a lot of this stuff go away. I also serve on Veterans Affairs and Safety, Agriculture with Representative Friend, and Natural Resources with Representative Friend. I have all the old guys on Natural Resources for some reason. So that's all I have. I'm kind of excited to get... The session started a little slow, like normal. It takes about 2 or 3 weeks to get rolling, but this upcoming week's going to be a very busy week. I have meetings with... back to my committee, the mayor of Hammond. He has several issues that he would like to talk about getting rid of. So this is what I'm looking for. So, but I can't do it without the organizations that we talked about. So you are part of that organization, so thank you very much.
So we have about 30 minutes for questions, and how we're going to handle the questions. By the way, I'm Amy, the executive director for the Fulton County Chamber of Commerce. I probably should say that. And we will say our special thank yous, but I don't want to take away from the amount of time that we have for questions. So how we're going to actually handle this is Joe Rood is going to be standing beside the person that has the question so that the gentleman can actually see who's asking the question and also to direct that. So if you do have a question, raise your hand. Joe will come to you. You can ask that question. We don't have an extra mic, so if you could just speak loudly, that would be helpful. The gentleman will be speaking or sitting here and answering the questions as they see fit. So for 30 minutes, we'll do that, and then we'll adjourn and say our thank yous. And we want to say thank you first, though. I have to say this. Mayor Ted Denton is one of my favorite people, and I said say a few words. And he and I carry the same lack of few words, and I love that about him. So, but it's the best. So if y'all could just take the questions as you see fit.
I'll get started. I had one of our citizens who couldn't make it today send me a text and want to know from any of you if anything was happening with Bill 1624 relative to solar panel alternative energy in the state of Indiana.
Thanks, Mayor. And I am a co-author on House Bill 1624. Representative Speedy, Tor, and I are on that bill. Bill deals with kind of an incentive or a recognition that public buildings, schools, courthouses, anything public would be able to take advantage of solar panels and we get a little bit into the weeds here, but how the power goes back onto the grid and how much they pay for it and do they get advantage. And we want to encourage those sorts of things. So I look forward to hopefully having a hearing on that in the Utility Committee.
Thank you.
I have two items with regards to HB 1002, the road funding bill. As I understand it, presently, part of the bill calls for the sales tax on fuel beginning in 2021 to all go to road construction. that's 4 years down the road. That would be phased in. Representative Friend, you mentioned, I believe, that currently 2.5 cents of that 7 cents goes to the general fund. The other 4.5 cents, I think, probably would be about $140 million. So $140 million a year that, beginning in 2021, is going to be removed from the general fund. Earlier this session, Speaker Bosma, as reported in the media, indicated that there's no plan yet for how to replace that $140 million once that takes effect in 2021. And the news article mentioned that, of course, the general fund helps to pay for education, health care, prisons, and nearly everything else in state government. I'm concerned, and I guess I would be interested in, is this really something we want to launch into, saying that in 2021, $140 million is going to be removed from the general fund, and yet no one is indicating how that might be accomplished. And I'm just concerned, well, gee, so you're going to be something else in terms of increased taxes in 2021, 4 years down the road, to compensate for that. So I'd be interested in any comments with regards to that. The second question, with regards to HB 1002, is there any provision in the bill, directly or indirectly, that would allow for development of maintenance and maintenance of walking and biking trails or anything else related to trails? And particularly, I have in mind dollars that flow back to towns and counties. Is there the flexibility for money to be used in that way, or is there something in the bill that would preclude that?
Thank you, President. Second part of the your question, I don't think there is any mention of recreational trails in House Bill 1002. There are bills filed that are trying to get some funding mechanism in place so that trails that are crisscrossing the state of Indiana would be able to maintain the facilities. There's already been considerable dollars spent on those trails. There's nothing available for them to accept through donations, contributions, bake sales, whatever they want to do, and volunteer labor. There's nothing other than that to help maintain them. And sooner or later, all this pavement is going to be in sad shape if there is no mechanism created. But it's not in 1002. There are some other bills out there, and we'll see if any of that proceeds. On your first point, taking the sales tax on gasoline, 2.5 cents right now of the 7 goes to the Motor Vehicle Highway Fund. Over the next 3 to 4 years, the plan is, in the bill, to capture the rest of that and send it to the Motor Vehicle Highway Fund. Now, there is no plan in 1002 to deal with that hole that is created in the general fund. Nothing like that at this time. There are suggestions out there, and of course, nothing you want to hear about here in Fulton County, but it probably deals with the cigarette tax. There are some bills in the process that have been filed on that. So, but I don't think there's any plan at this time to replace the money. It's just being moved over a period of time from the general fund to MVH. So that is to be determined, and we'll see. We'll just have to watch what develops.
Wouldn't it be smart to address that at the same time that we're doing HB 1002?
Well, it's not in 1002 at this point. And all I can tell you is there are other alternatives that are filed throughout that 1,600 bills or whatever there are, and that it'll be addressed, I'm pretty certain, but I'm not sure what the mechanism is at this time. I don't think any of us do.
Thanks. Yeah, so my question is, you had mentioned you're the co-sponsor of the HB 1624, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And that, from what I could tell reading it, was generally going to hopefully expand the use of solar at these institutions kind of dispersed across the state. That's something we're particularly interested in. I work up at Ancilla, Fort Handmaids in Marshall County, and Jack, I believe you're our representative. And there seems to be another piece of legislation in the Senate right now that is a little further along, SB 309, I believe, which has a different take, and all things equal appears to be curtailing that and would reduce all these things we're talking about, maximizing personal freedom, you know, individual energy independence, that sort of thing. It seems like those seem to be, how are those going to be reconciled if both of those end up moving forward? What's the process with that?
I've not spoken with Senator Hirschman. 309 belongs to Senator Hirschman. He doesn't have any co-authors. 1624 is Representative Speedy Tor and myself. Hopefully we can move 1624, which is a kind of an incentive-based or an encouragement for public buildings to make use of solar and alternative energy. So hopefully that bill will move, and perhaps the other one will not. But I have not spoken with Senator Hirschman yet to see what his intention is. Okay?
Brett Boggs from had a question for me on that same issue that he emailed me about earlier. I've tried to get with the author of 309 to get a better understanding of it. And we just started that discussion yesterday, and it didn't go very far. But I'm going to continue that, and he's also given me the number of someone else to talk about. My impression is, as yours was, that 309 would curtail it more. And then I think the brief synopsis of it is that the author or people in support of that bill feel like if you're generating your own power, you're getting a windfall somehow, and that you should have to help pay to maintain the grid, because if your source of power went down, you would depend on the grid to supply you. I think that bill is, the author thought that bill would get a hearing sometime in February. He said there were changes coming to it. I don't yet know what they are. Your other question is, if the two bills are on the same topic and they're different and they both move, is there a process for reconciliation? There's not a formal process, but typically the bill that's passed last is the one that would become law. The most recent bill would supersede anything that came before it. Most of the time, though, when there are two bills on the same topic, the authors from both chambers get together and say, let's figure out which bill is going to move and try to come to an agreement, so that if that doesn't happen, everyone in each house may be proud of their bill, but the other house kills it. It is typically how that winds up. So most of the time on the same topic, people have to get together to achieve something. And if you want to give me your name before you leave, I'll get your contact info and follow up on 309 and give you more and bring more as well.
Randy, I'll tell you, if they're concerned about us helping pay for the grid, we're already doing that. Any excess electricity that we don't use, we sell back to the grid at 3 cents less per kilowatt hour than what we pay for.
Understand.
So, I mean, we're already doing that.
Gotcha.
Are we doing that?
Okay. You got a question?
In looking at your pie chart, HHS is $2.7 billion, is that correct?
It's probably the pie chart.
HIP 2.0 HHS?
Yes.
2.7. Where's that money come from?
Well, this is all general fund. This is general fund appropriations. That's the heading on the pie chart. So that money would be a general fund appropriation. This is how the general fund is appropriated. And so that $2.7 billion would come from a variety of sources: the sales tax, the income tax, corporate income tax, cigarette tax, you know, all of those things would be in the general fund. Okay?
Well, okay. All right.
Does that answer your question, or you want to go somewhere else?
No, it's in the general fund.
Yes.
Right.
But it's a general fund appropriation.
Right. But the majority of that, okay, That's enough. Thank you.
Ma'am? Go ahead, ma'am.
If I can get out of here. I would just like to say that I'm Mary Lou Moho, originally from Napanee, Indiana. I've lived in a variety of different states. I came back to my home state, in which I've always loved. One thing that bothers me is that on this page where it says how much taxpayers have saved, ever since I've been back, there's been one mantra throughout the state of Indiana, and that is cut taxes. Nobody likes to pay taxes. At the same time, you get what you pay for. And if you look at our state as a whole, there are many areas in which we are lacking. Everything from education, through health care, through helping children, just a variety of medical things. There's just a variety of issues. Now, if you want to look at where these taxes have been cut, these taxes have been cut with the inheritance. That goes for people that are making $100,000 or more. Corporate taxes have been cut. Income taxes have been cut. Here we are in 2017, and we say, oh, we don't have money for roads. So you come asking us for taxes. I don't mind paying taxes. What I do mind is who is going to now have to pay the taxes, since you have instituted a program that benefits people with money more than people who do not have money. People now who have to drive distances for their jobs and don't have much money are going to have to pay this. They have to pay extra money for their cars. So now this is not going to hurt the wealthy. It's going to hurt the average person that can barely meet their bills. And I, at my age, would like to see somehow this state, instead of having being so excited about the taxes that they say, why can't we have a program that says excellence in Indiana, in all areas? We're going to take care of our, we're eighth in some polls. We're down with some of the poorest states in some areas. We can do better. We should be doing better. We have to do better. If you want to know why some of our best and brightest leave school and don't come back, talk to me, because I can tell you. They want more and they deserve more, and the citizens of this state deserve more. At the same time, I would like to thank all of you for your service. Especially Randy Head, we have gone head to head on issues. But I'll tell you, when I called him, I was very surprised, because he actually answered the phone himself. And I really appreciate your time and effort, and I know you all could be doing something else, but I would like to see us take a different turn. Let's be the best state. Let's be Minnesota. Let's be New York. Let's be California. We could do that. At least we would have it as our goal.
Thank you. And I kind of agree with you. Over the last 8-9 years, we have cut taxes in one way or another 13 times. But I kept questioning, what are we going to fill that hole with? Back to your point. And now here we are. And now we have to have some kind of a tax to kind of fill that hole. I think it'll work. I didn't agree with all the tax cuts. They had another one coming around that they were trying to, there's a bill out, so you don't have to have a permit, get a permit to carry a handgun. Well, that permitting process, I'm told, generates about $5 million a year, and that money is used for training for law enforcement and other agencies. So if we get rid of that, well, where's that money going to come from? We're kind of robbing Peter to pay Paul. I'm a little tired of that. Okay, so, but we did have 13 tax cuts, and some of them were probably good, some of them maybe not so good.
Questions?
question I have, has there been a study why the highways are being tore up like they are now? And the other thing, I drove for United Parcel for 30 years, and I followed semis before that's been overweight. Do we weigh them like we used to, the semis? I think we need to get on that and see why our roads are not standing up like they used to. And a lot of equipment going over it that's heavy, very heavy now. So I was wondering if there's a study so we find out why they're being tore up, and then maybe we can save some money.
Thanks, Ted. Part of this whole study that was done as we came up with this composite of 1002 included truck traffic and freight, and diesel fuel goes up 10 cents, and then there's a supplemental charge for the trucks as well. So yes, the there is a calculation, I don't know it off the top of my head, but there's a calculation about how much damage, how much more damage a fully loaded semi would do versus a passenger vehicle. And it's considerable, it really is. But within 1002, there is an additional charge for the diesel fuel, for the highway diesel fuel, not on the farm. The tractors are in the field, you know, they're not on the road. But for the highway use diesel fuel, which is the yellow stuff, yes, there will be a supplemental charge to help offset the damage and to contribute to the maintenance of the highways.
Do we still weigh our semis? I don't see the scales like we used to.
Yes, we do. Yes. DOT is always out there stopping and weighing and doing that sort of thing. And if I'm not mistaken, we are in the process of rebuilding. There's a weigh station down on 65 by Seymour. You go right by. It's been closed for some time, but I think we're in the process of redoing that.
I don't know about all the trucks that are getting weighed, but in the aggregate business, in these stone quarries and so forth, they are responsible for overloads. If they go across the scales and they're heavy, they have to dump them before they leave. So they have to.
I've seen ruts in 31, you know, yeah. Before, and that really tears them up.
Yeah, just a brief comment. As far as study on damage by trucks for those boilermakers in here, Purdue did do a study on damage by trucks, and as you might expect, it's significant. And what 1002 tries to do is, historically, I didn't know this, but companies actually pay outside of even gas taxes. There's an honor system where they log how many miles they drove in Indiana, and then there's this honor system that they submit it and pay a tax on that. We're trying to work through on this honor system because we've been told there's been some cheating going on, which you might surprise some people in this room. So we're trying to get that under control a little bit. And also we have a pilot going on in northwest Indiana on weighing trucks vis-a-vis a new technology, of which I'm not sure what that is. But again, because of the severe damage it does, and as opposed to having weigh stations that might hit or miss depending on the route of that truck, there are other ways I hear you can do it through technology, and we're doing a pilot on this new technology, of which I was fearful to bring it up because I don't understand the specifics of that technology.
A lot of them run at night so they don't get caught, but now Michigan has all those tires on trucks, if you notice. I don't know. But then our trucks going up there are small tires. Do they pay more going into that state because they don't have a lot of...
On your road funding bill, is there any, do you know what the formula is for distributing the money? Is it going to be based on how much each county pays in fuel tax, or is it going to be divided by 92, let's say?
Of course, it's all done by formula, as you well know. The NDOT formula. And it seems to me, if I remember correctly, there is a, what do you call it, community crossings fund. Okay, the $15 registration fee is supposed to generate, I think, about $90 million. That is all dedicated to that community crossings fund, which is a matching grant, and I believe it's 80-20. I believe it's 80-20.
Is that right? Dollar for dollar.
The new bill is 80-20. We tried to increase the amount that the state was going to contribute and decrease the amount that the locals would have. So that 90, but the balance of the MVH, I believe it's like 47% local and 53% to the state. I think that's correct, Barry. We'll have to see how this all shakes out, but I believe that's where we are. One thing that I don't want any confusion here. The tax on gasoline, whether it is the sales tax, whether it is the per gallon tax, it is dedicated to the MVH, Motor Vehicle Highway Fund, and the LRNS, Local Road and Street Fund. That's where the money goes. It does not get commingled with the general fund. I've had many people say, I'm not so unhappy with the 10 cents if you will guarantee that you're not going to blow it in the general fund on something else. Fuel taxes go to the MVH and the LRNS funds. They don't run through the general fund, except for that sales tax, which we're trying to get moved over as well.
I'm Kevin Omar from Marfa
County. Yeah, you got to live in Fulton County to ask a question. This forum is so good, commissioners from Marshall County come down.
You have the bottom half of our county.
Right.
I'm in your district.
No. All right, I'll answer your question.
I just have a couple comments. When you guys changed the sales tax back in 2014, you know, in 2014, we were receiving about $2.5 million from MVH. When you guys did the sales tax, the next year we got $3.4 million. This year, we're expecting to get less than the we're going to be about $30,000 short on our MVH funds from the previous year. The MVH keeps going down. Local road and street stays the same. I applaud the community crossings. What you guys did this year, we applied for $1 million for a dollar match, and we got $2 million. We hot mixed asphalt roads 18 miles. So when you take that 18 miles and divide that by $2.2 million, that's over $100,000 a mile. And we keep continuing to get less and less money through our MVH because cars are getting better gas mileage, people aren't driving as much. So I think it's a good thing. The only thing I don't like about 1002 is the frontal swap program. I am a little bit leery about that, trading state dollars for federal dollars. When we do federal aid projects, it's 80-20 split. If you go through this federal swap program, and I'm just doing this in layman's term, it would be incumbent upon the local agencies, local government, to pay for right-of-way, engineering, environmental, those type of things, and the state would pay for the construction of that. My question is, what guarantee is there if we go through this whole process that the money will be there to do the project? So, and I hope that you guys continue doing the community corrections program. We are involved in that now. We get grant money from the state of Indiana for community corrections where we can put people on ankle bracelets, keep them out of the jail. Last month, we only had about less than 100 people in the jail. This month, we're running about 120 people, where we could be closer to 200, but we have 60 to 70 people in that program now. So it's saving taxpayers money by not having them in the jail. The county's not paying for the health care costs, not paying for the medicine, they're back home, being hopefully functional people in our society. So, and one other thing is with the tax caps, Cume Bridge funds, when the county starts hitting tax caps, our bridge fund is receiving less and less money every year because it's based on property taxes. When those houses departments and businesses are hitting their tax caps, we're getting less and less money for bridges. We have about 8 to 10 bridges that we need either rehabbed or replaced, and the bridge is about $1.8 million. So, you know, we're looking at $18 million. Our huge bridge fund is just not keeping up. So, highways have not kept up with the cost of doing business for highway departments. The cost of doing business for highways continues to go up. Our revenue does not keep up with those costs. So that's my comments. I don't have any questions.
We have time for one more question.
Go ahead, Bob. My name is Bob Peterson. I don't have a question, but I'd like to comment on an issue that's important to me that all of you talk about, and that's education. My privilege to be a member of the State Senate in the 1960s when we reorganized schools. It was a stressful project, but out of that came some good schools. North Miami, Caston, Rochester, Tippecanoe Valley. My children went through the Rochester schools and got a good education. But it's been a concern to me how much money we pull out of the public education money for private schools, for charter schools, vouchers, and private schools. Now, that's causing stress in rural schools, and basically all of our schools in this area are what you would call rural schools. Now, if you have not seen it, Brett Boggs, who is right here in Superintendent Tippecanoe Valley, has had an issue published about a month ago in the Rochester papers, the future of Indiana's small rural schools. Well, I guess you'd say that we're all rather small schools. It's a concern to me that we're pulling money out of public education money and put it into vouchers and charter schools. And we don't have much of those in our area very much. I don't know of any charter schools.
Right, none.
In our, pardon?
Zero.
Zero, okay. And so that money is being taken out and put into private schools, charter schools, and the pressure is on rural schools as to what we're going to do. Now, maybe there'll be some problems with places where, like some of our schools, will lose population. They'll have to address that issue. But I would like to ask if they consider the legislature of eliminating, if possible, and certainly reducing the amount of public money that goes into private and charter schools. And if you haven't read Mr. Boggs' article, I've got a couple copies here, and you should read it because there's pressure on. Now, it's my understanding that I believe I read recently, for Indiana, more public money, at least percentage-wise, into private education than does any other state in the nation. And I think that should be an issue to address. If we don't, we're going to get this continual pressure on public money going into private schools. And I would ask that you consider that in the future, that that either be eliminated or certainly reduced. And it would reduce the problem of stress on local public schools.
Bob, I tried to address with the small school grant program. This House bill, I think it's 1143. And I have that bill filed in the House, and I have Representative Gutwein and I are both on it. And we are working with those folks in Ways and Means to address some of the issues of the population drain in our small rural schools. Now, the bigger issue is, why are those parents of child-rearing age, why are they not staying here? Why are they going to Fishers, Indiana, to put their kids in Hamilton Southeastern, where there's 22,500 students? Makes no sense to me, but it has to come back to employment opportunity and to quality of life issues, that sort of thing. That's why it's happening. And so we have to work harder at economic development and things of that nature up here in the more rural areas in order to hopefully maintain the population in these small schools and at least address the financial side with a few more dollars.
Since they started the voucher program, the numbers that I was given 8% of the vouchers since we started this program are in rural schools. The number at that time was like 2,500 students statewide actually went to a private school in the rural areas, 8%. So I would be curious to know how many students your school corporation has lost to the voucher program over the last 5 years. Sometimes I think it's the whole mindset is we took state money and gave it to private schools.
That's about all we have time for. I'm sorry, but the gentleman actually will be here to answer any other specific questions, but just had a few things I would like to say. I want to say specifically a thank you to the gentleman. Obviously, coming out on a Saturday morning at 7:30 is probably not their favorite thing to do, so I appreciate them coming out. I also do appreciate, and they alluded to it, this is not the first time that they've been here. They have been here multiple times, whether it was on the phone or in person, to actually speak about education. And they listened very well. Lengthy conversations, multiple conversations, but I want to publicly thank them for their time and effort. I know it's a very tricky situation and can be a little bit volatile at times. So, but I feel like they have heard what we've said, and I know that they're in constant conversations with the superintendent, so I wanted to say a public thank you for that, because they didn't have to do that. So we appreciate that time and effort. And I also wanted to say a special thank you to my partners that are here. Joe, raise your hand. And John, where's John? So we could not do this without the Fulton County Farm Bureau. They work very diligently with us to make it efficient. I know that we could have them have third house sessions and we could also have third house sessions, but to make the time efficient for everybody, we partner on this event. And Doug said, don't do that. So I appreciate the time and effort that they put in to make this happen. Also, I wanted to say a special thank you. And they had to run out the door, but Rochester FFA, they were here, and they opened the door for you today. And our sweet Boy Scouts, who were actually at City Council the other day, they also had to run out the door, and they were gracious to do their little Pledge of Allegiance and Honor Guard. So a special thank you to them and to my board members who are here. Could you raise your hand if you are a Fulton County Chamber of Commerce board member? So I appreciate the opportunity to really move into some legislative issues. It was something that we spoke about last year when I came on the board, to be able to have the opportunity to connect more with legislation, to be able to have a voice. I know it's a little bit scary at times to do that because the whole issue of politics can be exciting. So I appreciate the opportunity to be able to connect with the legislative process and also to be able to have these folks here and be able to speak. I wanted to say also thank you to Chris Lee, if you could stand up, Chris. He is Congresswoman Jackie Valorski's community liaison. Did I get your title right?
That's awesome. That's
close
awesome.
Enough for that one. And so he is here on her behalf, so he will also answer any questions on the federal level. We did have a request from the community to invite our federal folks. Some were not able to attend, so they were invited. Whoever asked that question, I think it was, yeah. So Chris is here as a representative for that. And last but not least, I forgot Hope. We've got to talk about Hope. I wrote myself a note, so she's sweet. Can't forget her. I wanted to, if anybody that is elected, appointed, or a superintendent of education, if you could stand in the room for me at this moment.
Is that actually Marshall County?
Marshall County, why not? We just thank you for your efforts on a local level and on a county level to be able to support us. I know that Chad, I don't think Phyllis is here, but I worked very hard to provide us the opportunity to connect. And so what I always like to say, I'm a little bit of a nerd about this, is that if you do not connect on a state level or on a national level, please make sure that you speak to one of these elected, appointed, or superintendents to be able to be a part of the legislative process, because that's why they're here. They want to hear your voice. They want to make sure that what is necessary to happen happens, and that we provide the best we can for our future and for our community. So make sure you say thank you to them, and make sure you speak to them in between the meetings. So speaking of that, our next meeting will be February 25th. That is a Saturday. And we will be at the Fulton Community Center. And so please make sure that you support the Fulton folks, because they've been here. And I know that not all the gentlemen can come. I think that a couple of them have prior engagements, but I believe that a few will be there. Am I correct about that?
Right.
We'll figure out the details later. Schedules are tight. In addition, the last one will be March 25th, and that is at the Kiwanis Public Library. And so we wanted to make sure that we gave each part of the county an opportunity to have their voice heard, and also to make sure that we highlight. Obviously, being able to go there, you are able to see different things that you wouldn't see by just maybe speaking about it. So we will have that. I know Charlie Rood was here, and he's very excited. So please make sure you come out in droves also, because he sat there and counted every single one of the tables, every single one of the chairs, and is calculating details in his head. So he's very excited about that. So those meetings will be from 7:30 to 9:30, same agenda. So I believe that's everything. I wanted to say thank you to each and every one of you for coming out. Obviously, we are very proud. They say this often. We are the largest showing of support. At least that's what I like to think. At least that's what they tell us. So we're just grateful to each of you for coming out at 7:30 in the morning on a Saturday. This officially concludes the actual program, but they have said that they will stay around, so please don't hesitate to ask questions. If there's donuts, please take them, because I don't want to eat them. So thank you so much for your time.